James Stewart by Donald Dewey. The book is subtitled A Biography. Dedication for Gene Dewey and Virginia Delaney. Introduction. Introduced to a mass audience as an actor more than 60 years ago, James Stewart quickly found other, sometimes competing identities. As the Hollywood star, as the World War II hero, as the stalwart family man, and as a paradigm of the small-town idealist who brings American simplicity and integrity to encrusted big-city cynics. Harry Truman said he would have made a perfect son, Natalie Wood said he would have made a perfect father, and Gloria Stewart said he did make a perfect husband. Depending on the thrust over the years of a particular magazine article or press release, we have had Stewart the actor presented as an extension of the private Stewart of Indiana, Pennsylvania, Beverly Hills, California, and several points in between, or the private Stewart of Indiana, Beverly Hills, and elsewhere portrayed as so suffusing his professional material as to suggest that maybe he never really acted at all. For many, Stewart the actor has often seemed like an afterthought, or as one knee-jerk evaluation of his work would put it, "Oh, that's Jimmy Stewart just being Jimmy Stewart." There have been many accomplices to Jimmy Stewart just being Jimmy Stewart. To begin with, there is Stewart himself, who only sporadically has reared up against a confusion of his talent with his image, and who even on those occasions has made it clear that he considers Parent of the Year awards from Reader's Digest as important as Oscars, and both of them less important than military honors or election to eldership in the Presbyterian Church. His recitation of the benefits of growing up as the son of Alexander and Elizabeth Stewart, of working under the old Hollywood studio system, and of acting for Frank Capra, John Ford, and Alfred Hitchcock, recorded in thousands of newspaper interviews and public appearances, has taken on the predictability of a ritual. Asked directly about his acting technique, he usually has retreated behind a barricade of self-deprecation, though not without firing a shot or two back at acting schools and, more particularly, at disciples of the method. Asked for his favorite motion picture role, he invariably has cited the one, George Bailey in It's a Wonderful Life, that, thanks to relentless television promotion every Christmas, has been reduced to a Hallmark greeting card character, making Stewart's frequently dangerous performance something more observed than seen. His very survival as practically the last of the studio stars, once counted by MGM as outnumbering those in the heavens, has conferred on him an emblematic significance more conducive to appreciating movie history than the nuances and subtleties of living screen art. Caricature, well past a point of comic flattery and into another zone of bland reassurance, has long been a Stewart companion. Here again, the actor has been no passive recipient of the obviousnesses of others. In fact, there is some evidence to indicate that after World War II, he himself gilded his natural stammerings and elliptical phrase-making as a commercial calculation, as a conscious attempt to help shape a persona that would prove attractive at the box office. However that might be, by the time he was fitfully wrapping his tongue around his jingles for Johnny Carson and the Tonight Show audience in the 1980s, Stewart had certainly become the most durable and accurate of the Jimmy Stewart impersonators. Those scores of flinty film performances without an or a wall in them? They remained locked away in the basement of the Jimmy Stewart Institution, which is to say locked behind our own selective memories. In some instances, the passing of years, when not decades, has provided us with a reasonable excuse for seeing only what we want to see. We can be forgiven, for example, for overlooking his reputation as a womanizer in the 1930s and 1940s, before he was hailed as a paragon of the family man, when his incessant prowlings began to worry even his closest male friends. Where other attitudes are concerned, say in the thought that this 1932 graduate of Princeton probably learned to read by memorizing the letters off the label of his bib overalls, we have unwittingly reflected an old MGM publicity slant where ivy was never supposed to flourish near innocence. But beyond such oversights, our blinded perspectives explained less easily, where what might be folksy, shy, respectful, or trustworthy about Stewart personally has been projected into a broader cultural context that some of us might yearn to believe, but that many more of us mainly perceive as some comfortably removed relic of a quaint past. Either way, Stewart himself remains out of focus. Take a wider view of Stewart's most parodied characteristic, his speech, specifically the notion that he has found speaking an arduous process, that his every syllable in front of a camera was produced by tapping his brain with a mouse.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.